Hello dear students, very good morning. Today we are going to discuss with the anatomy of anal canal. Anal canal is also part of gastrointestinal tract. It is a last part of the gastrointestinal tract. As you have heard about the hemorrhoids, piles, fistula in anus, fissure, etc. These are all clinical aspects related to that of anal canal. To know this clinical aspect, first we have to go for study of gross anatomy of the anal canal. So we are starting with the gross anatomy of the anal canal. So learning objective related to the anal canal is to learn the structure and location of anal canal, to learn external features of the anal canal, to learn internal features of the anal canal, to learn arterial supply of anal canal, nerve supply of anal canal, venous drainage and lymphatic drainage of the anal canal, to learn the clinical anatomy related to anal canal. So the clinical anatomy related to anal canal is a very important part present, that is the hemorrhoids, fissures, etc. These are very commonly seen conditions in a India like countries. So introduction. Anal canal is situated below the level of pelvic diaphragm. It lies in the anal triangle of perineum in between right and left ischioanal fossae. So it is situated just between the right and left ischioanal fossae. So if you are seeing that, this is the part of the right ischioanal fossa, this is the part of the left ischioanal fossa present. So this is the right ischioanal fossa, this is left ischioanal fossa. In between to that, you are seeing that the canal is present. This canal is called anal canal. The sacculations and tinea are absent here also, like that of the rectum. The sacculations and tinea are absent. This is the very important histological or the gross anatomical structure. The length of the anal canal is 3.8 cm or 38 mm long. Its extent and direction, from where to where it is extending and what its direction is. So it is directed downwards and backwards. The anus is the surface opening of the anal canal, situated about 4 cm below and in front of tip of coccyx vertebrae. So tip of coccyx vertebrae ke samne aur niche ki taraf lagbhag 4 cm samne aur niche ki taraf, there is the opening of anal canal is present, and that opening of anal canal that used to call as anus. This is the generally the basic concept related to that of anal canal. If you used to go for these are the ischial tuberosities are there. So these are the ischial tuberosity. If you used to draw imaginary lines of the trapezium, and if you used to draw the diagonal, so interior to that there would be the urogenital triangle is present, and just posterior to that there is an anal triangle is present. So at present we are concerned with the anal triangle structure basically. Now here again, this is the pelvic diaphragm structure is. So pelvic diaphragm is formed by levator ani muscle and coccygeus muscle. This is the levator ani muscle, this is levator ani, and levator ani muscle is formed by iliococcygeus and pubococcygeus. So iliococcygeus, pubococcygeus and coccygeus, that's combinedly they used to be formed, and that too with the piriformis muscle, they used to be forms the part of pelvic diaphragm. Pelvic diaphragm is having two openings in the males and three openings in the females. So there is a one opening present for the anal canal is there. That so we are today we are going to be have a discussion with this gross anatomy of the anal canal, and it is going to be downwards as the anus is. Just anterior to that there is opening is present, that is for vagina in females, and thus anterior to that there is a opening for urethra is present, that is common to both male and female is. Now, the relations of the anal canal. Relations, so anteriorly in both the sexes that anal canal is related with the perineal body, then in females, in a males, that is a membranous urethra and bulb of penis is related, whereas in females the lower end of vagina is related. In females there is a lower end of vagina, in a males there is a membranous urethra and the part of bulb of the penis is related. So this is the membranous part of the urethra, is this is the membranous part of a urethra, and there would be the bulb of penis is there. So this is related in the males. In females there is a lower part of lower end of the vagina is related. Posteriorly there is a anococcyxial ligament, that is in both, and the tip of the coccyx. So this is you are seeing, this is the anococcyxial ligament present, that is found to be connected with the anus to the tip of the coccyx vertebrae, that is anococcyxial ligament, and that too with the tip of the coccyx vertebra, that is related posteriorly. Laterally, there are both the ischioanal fossas are related, that we have already discussed in the ischioanal fossa also and in the introductory part also. All around, the anal canal is surrounded by sphincter muscle and the tone keeps the anal canal close. That is on all sides, there is the sphincter muscle is found to be situated, and this sphincter muscle maintains the tone of the anal canal, and that used to be keeps close the anuses. Interior of the anal canal. The interior of the canal shows mainly important features and can be divided into three parts by a pectineal line and the Hilton's line. So pectineal line and the Hilton's line. So if you used to see, here is the line is present. This line is called pectineal line. And here is in a lower part the line is present, this line is called Hilton's line. So that is divided the area into the three parts, that is the upper part, and this is the middle part, and this one is the lowermost area. Is so this is upper 15 millimeter, middle 15 millimeter, and the lowermost 8 millimeter area is. So upper 15 millimeter, that is also known as mucous part, whereas the intermediate 15 millimeter, that is the second one area, is that is also known as a transitional zone or pectin part. Transitional zone or pectin part, whereas lower 8 millimeter area is there. This is the lower 8 millimeter area. This is known as cutaneous part. So mucus part, transitional part, and cutaneous part. Upper 15 millimeter, middle 15 millimeter, and lowermost 8 millimeter is. So 15, 15, 8. So 30 and 8, 3.8 or 38 millimeter, that's a whole length is there. Now next, this is again the upper 15 millimeter, middle 15 millimeter, and lower 8 millimeter is. So if you used to see to the areas are here, this is the line present, this line that used to call as pectinate line is there. This line is called pectin line, this is a pectin line, this line is called Hilton's line. So this is the above area, that is the mucus area present. Then this is the second part is intermediate area or intermediate zone is, and this is the cutaneous area is. So upper, middle, and the lower areas. In this way, this upper area is again, it is a 15 millimeter long. It is 15 millimeter long and it is 8 millimeter long is. So now interior of the anal canal that used to shows, that is upper mucus part. What are the characters present that to be the upper mucus part is? So this part is 15 millimeter long, that is one character present. It is lined by a mucous membrane and it is endodermal in condition. That mucous membrane shows 16 to 10 vertical ridges or the anal columns. So there are about 16 to 10 vertical ridges are present. These are the vertical ridges. These are the vertical ridges. So these 16 to 10 vertical ridges, or these are also known as anal columns or the columns of Morgagni. So these are the columns of Morgagni are there. So this is these are the columns present. These are the columns of Morgagni. that you are seeing here at in the diagram. The lower end of the NL columns are united to each other and they forms the NL valves. So here are the they are united at the lower and they used to be forms the NL valves. So these are the NL valves present. Above each valve there is the depression in the mucosa which is called NL sinus. So above the each valve there is a depression is present and that depression is called NL sinus. So NL valve is what the lower end of the NL columns are united to each other and they used to be forms the NL valves, and above each valve there is a depression is present of the depression of the mucosa is present, that depression of mucosa is called NL sinuses there. NL valves together forms a transverse line. These NL valves are there. These NL valves again they used to be forms a transverse line. This transverse line is called pectinate line or dentate line. This line is called pectinate line. This is there. This line is there. This line is called pectinate line or dentate line. Now that comes to the middle part is there. The middle, the next 15 millimeter area is part is called the middle part of the NL canal. This is also lined by a mucous membrane. It is also that as like that of the upper part. This part is also lined by a mucous membrane. Is that mucosa is less mobile than in the upper part of NL canal. Is as the upper part of the NL canal that mucosa is more mobile and the and a lower part that mucosa is less mobile. Now comes to the next, that is this region is referred to as pectin or the transitional zone. So this part is called pectin part, or this is also known as transitional zone. The lower limit of the pectin has a whitish appearance because of which it is referred to as white line of Hilton. So here is the ultimately this is called white line of Hilton is there, and this is called pectin line that has divided the NL canal into these two lines, has divided the NL canal into three parts, that is upper, middle, and this is the lower part. Is lower cutaneous part, middle part is transitional part, whereas the upper part is a mucous part. Now lower cutaneous part, it is about 8 millimeter long and it is lined by a true skin containing the sebaceous glands. So it is the true part is there. This is this part is called this used to call as the cutaneous part is. So the lowermost part, lowermost 8 millimeter long structure is. So this is the upper part, middle part, and the lower part is. This is the your pectinate line or the pectin line, and this is the Hilton's line present. Now comes to the musculature of NL canal. The NL canal has musculature, that is the NL sphincters are there. So NL sphincter, anatomy of the NL sphincter, there is a internal NL sphincter and external NL sphincter. The external NL sphincter forms the single functional and anatomic entity. The uppermost fibers blends with the fibers of puborectalis muscle. So that uppermost fibers are going to be blends with the puborectalis muscle. This puborectalis muscle and these sphincters used to be takes in a formation of the NL ring. They used to be takes participation in formation of NL ring is there. This is again very important part that we will see. The internal NL sphincter, it is involuntary in nature. Internal NL sphincter, so it is internal NL structure is involuntary in nature. Downward and thickened extension of circular muscle fibers of the rectum. It is a downward and thickened extension of circular muscle fibers. So inner circular muscle fibers are there, just you are seeing here. So these inner circular muscle fibers are extension of these inner circular muscle fibers as a downward direction, that used to call as internal. They will form the internal NL sphincter. This is the internal NL sphincter that you are seeing. These are the muscular inner circular muscle fibers. They are coming downwards as the and they used to be forms the internal NL sphincter. It surrounds the upper three fourths like that of for example of 30 millimeter of the anal canal. 30 millimeter means total anal canal is approximately 3.8 millimeter. So that upper 3/4 part is covered by, it is enclosed by the internal anal sphincter. It is the extending from upper end of the anal canal to the white line of Hildane. That is extending from upper part to the white line of Hildane. So this is the white line of Hildane. So from this upper and middle, upper mucus part and middle zone to up to the level of the white line, there is the internal sphincter is present. Internal anal sphincter is present. Now the external anal sphincter, it is under voluntary control. It is under voluntary control. It is made up of striated muscle fibers. It is made up of striated muscle fibers. It is supplied by inferior rectal nerve. It surrounds the whole length of the anal canal. It has a three parts, that is a subcutaneous, superficial and deep part. Uppermost part or the uppermost fibers blends with the fibers of puborectalis muscle, and they used to be take participation in formation of anal ring is there, that too with the fibers of puborectalis muscle. The anal sphincter continuous part, that is uppermost fibers blends with the fibers of puborectalis muscle. There are upper, middle and lower fibers are there. So uppermost fibers blends with the puborectalis muscle. These are the uppermost fibers, these are the middle fibers, these are middle fibers and these are the lower fibers. So these uppermost fibers blends with the, this is the puborectalis muscle is there, that you are seeing that this is the puborectalis muscle. This is the pubis and this is the part of rectum. This is ultimately perianal flexor is present, that is perianal flexor is formed by your puborectalis muscle. Next is middle fibers are attached to the perineal body anteriorly and to the coccyx via enococcyxial ligament posteriorly. So here is the enococcyxial ligament present posteriorly. With that, there is a middle fibers are found to be attached. Lower fibers lie below the level of internal anal sphincter. Conjoint, next is next topic is next musculature part is, that is the conjoint longitudinal cord. It is formed by fusion of puborectalis with the longitudinal muscle cord of the rectum at the anorectal junction. It lies between the external and internal sphincters. Anorectal ring, it is formed by fusion of puborectalis, uppermost fibers of the external sphincter and internal fibers. So external fibers, internal fibers and puborectalis, that used to be forms the anorectal ring. The surgical division of this ring results in a rectal incontinence. This is again it is important. Clinical anatomy related to that of the rectum, that is rectal incontinence. Next is arterial supply of the anal canal. The part of the anal canal above the pectinate line is supplied by superior rectal artery. So this is the superior rectal artery. That superior rectal artery is a direct, it is a direct, it is a branch of inferior mesenteric artery, and that used to be supplies. The part below the pectinate line is supplied by inferior rectal artery. If you are seeing that here is the inferior rectal artery is present. So this inferior rectal artery is a branch of inferior pudendal artery. Inferior pudendal artery is a branch of internal iliac artery. This is the internal iliac artery that used to be gives a branch. That branch is ultimately inferior pudendal artery, and inferior pudendal artery used to be bifurcates, and that used to be gives a branch, that is the inferior rectal artery. Is venous drainage, the internal rectal venous, the internal rectal venous plexus drains mainly into the superior rectal vein but communicates with the middle and inferior rectal vein. So this is the superior rectal vein present, this is the superior rectal vein. This superior rectal vein drains into inferior mesenteric vein, and this inferior mesenteric vein ultimately drains into the portal vein. Okay, so this inferior mesenteric ultimately drains into the portal veins. So that used to be forms portocaval anastomosis. The internal plexus is therefore an important site of communication between the portal and system circulation. Between portal and systemic circulation, the portocaval anastomosis is being formed. This is three portocaval anastomosis is being formed. Out of three, this is one important portocaval anastomosis, and due to that, hemorrhoids are found to be present. The external rectal venous plexus lies outside the muscular coat of the rectum and the anal canal. The external plexus is drained by the inferior rectal vein, by middle rectal vein, and by superior rectal vein. Now comes to the lymphatic drainage of the anal canal. That lymphatic vessels from part above the pectinate line drains with those of rectum into the internal iliac lymph nodes. So internal iliac lymph nodes are there. They used to be drains the part just above the pectinate lines. So pectinate line and above the pectinate line, they used to be drains into the internal iliac lymph nodes. Below the pectinate line, they drains into medial group of superficial inguinal lymph nodes. So pectinate line, above the pectinate line, they used to be drains into internal iliac lymph nodes, and below the pectinate line, they used to be drains into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. So this is the drainage, that is upper anal canal via channel around the rectum into the pre-aortic lymph nodes, and the lower anal canal below the dentate or the pectinate line into the inguinal lymph nodes. That is the ultimately drainage is found to be present. This is upward side is there, and this is the downward side is there. Now comes to the nerve supply. Nerve supply above the pectinate line, the anal canal is supplied by autonomic nerves, both sympathetic inferior hypogastric plexus, that is L1 to L2, and parasympathetic, that is pelvic splenic plexus, that is by S2, S3 and S4 nerves. Pain sensations are carried by both of them. Pain sensations, this is important part in the nerve supply. Pain sensations are carried out by both of them, by sympathetic and the parasympathetic parties. Below the pectinate line, it is supplied by somatic, that is inferior rectal S2, S3 and S4 nerves are there. Next is the nerve supply, that too with the sphincters. Sphincters, the internal sphincter is caused to contract by sympathetic nerves and is relaxed by parasympathetic nerves. The external sphincter is supplied by inferior rectal nerve and by perineal branch of fourth sacral nerve. This is the sphincter supply. Now comes to the clinical anatomy that were related with the anal canal. Piles, hemorrhoids are secular dilatations of internal rectal venous plexus. This is again important. Internal rectal venous plexus, this is one of the example of portocaval anastomosis present. So when there is a congestion is happened in the portal system, there would be leads to ultimately to the piles of the hemorrhoids. They occur above the pectinate line and are therefore they are painless. That is due to the nerve supply that we have discussed. The primary piles occurs in a 3 o'clock, 7 o'clock and 11 o'clock positions of the anal valve. So just you have to put your watch on the anal anal part or the lower part of the anal canal, that is on anus, and just you have to see whether this is the ultimately 12 o'clock position. So in a 3 o'clock position, this is the left lateral, this is your 7 o'clock position is situated here, and there is a 11 o'clock position is there. So this is a 11 o'clock position, 7 o'clock position and 3 o'clock position. So this and these are the primary sites for the that is hemorrhoids or the piles is there. This is again same example. So these are same left lateral primary piles. This is the left lateral primary pile, 3 o'clock position. This is the 3 o'clock position, that shows the left lateral primary plane. This is the 7 o'clock position that shows the right posterior primary piles, and this is the 11 o'clock position that shows right anterior primary piles. These are the positions these are present. Now this is the again 11 o'clock position, 7 o'clock position and 3 o'clock position. These are some internal hemorrhoids are there. These are called external hemorrhoids. This is the sample of internal hemorrhoids. So these are the internal hemorrhoids present, and these are the external hemorrhoids. External piles occurs below the pectinate line and are therefore very painful, because below the pectinate line that we have seen in the nerve supply also. Fissure in ano. Anal fissure is caused by rupture of one of the anal valve, usually by the passage of dry stool in the constipated patients. When the constipation is happening, the stool become dry and that will rupture the valves, anal valves, and that forms the anal fissure. Next is the fistula in ano. A fistula is a abnormal epithelialized tract connecting between the two cavities or one cavity with other exterior parties, so to the skin, to the part skin with the other parties. Fistula in ano is caused by spontaneous rupture of an abscess around the anus. If any abscess is present around the abscess or on the interior wall of the anal canal, and that is going to be communicated with the exterior of the skin of the anal anus or around the anus of the perineum, that is called fistula in ano. If you used to see, here is the there is a tract being formed that is called extra sphincteric tract. Here is the trans sphincteric tract. This is the tract is formed. Ultimately, it is going to be open at the skin level. This is inter sphincteric tract, and this is the tract being formed. It is a supra sphincteric tract. Now, pyelonidal sinus or the pyelonidal disease. Pyelonidal disease or the sinus. This is the cyst or the infection. This consists of hair containing sinus. This is a hair containing, important thing is that there is a hair containing sinus or abscess occurring in the intergluteal cleft. These ingrowing hairs may then become infected and present acutely as an abscess in the sacrococcygeal region. So, in a sacrococcygeal region or the intergluteal clefts, there is a hair containing sinus or abscesses occurring that used to call as pyelonidal sinus. If you are seeing that, these are the healed pyelonidal sinuses are there, and these are if you are excised pyelonidal sinuses, if you used to see, there are the hairs are present. So, this is these are hairs in the pyelonidal sinuses. This is the example that I have taken. This is a per rectal examination. We are discussing the rectum also. In a per rectal examination, in males there would be a prostate gland, seminal vagus, and in a females there is a lower part of a vagina, and if the baby is present, that can also be felt. In a posteriorly, there is a sacrum, anorectal ring, and the part of the coccyx that can be felt easily. Okay, so thank you very much for hearing me.